peoples, today known as the Esquimalt and Songhees Nations. I extend my appreciation for the opportunity to live and learn on this territory. I would like to introduce myself. My name is Kim Cobb. I'm a teacher at Selkirk Montessori School in Victoria, BC. And I'm also on the board of directors with the Young Global Citizens. Today we have a special guest, Senator Loffreda, who is going to introduce our other special guest today. So if I can hand it over to you, Senator.
Thank you very much. And Ambassador Ray, thank you for being here. Well, beautiful day here in Montreal, and I hope you see me well and hear me well. We are all grateful that you are here and took the time to be with us today. Back in November 2020, I had the pleasure of being one of the first interviewees of this movement. I have taken a key interest in these passionate teachers and their students, and I have witnessed impressive growth from a few dozen schools in Vancouver and Halifax to over 600 schools in 12 countries. Movement and group, and I'm very proud to have been one of the first interviewees, and I welcome you here today. The goals of Jeunes Citoyens du Monde is to serve the UN Sustainable Development Goals while also protecting Canadian values of openness, multiculturalism, and bilingualism. With their teacher support, students around the world research, write and ask questions of artists, authors, scientists, politicians, and other influencers. They increase their empathy and their critical sense, awareness of self and others, gain confidence in their abilities, and they become better equipped to address the global issues we all face today. And we all know that there is many. Their heart is also very close to the Indigenous people of Canada. Ambassador Ray, we have known you and followed you closely for many years, and you are now Canada's ambassador to the United Nations in New York. I think you will have a wonderful conversation with these young and bright students who give me and many others much hope for Canada's future. So thank you for being here today. Thank you for being with us. It's an honor and privilege to present you and to have you here with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Senator Loffreda, for taking the time out of your busy schedule today. Ambassador Ray, do you have anything you'd like to say before we start asking questions?
No, I think I'll just start with the questions. And if there's anything we can wrap up with at the end, that's fine. But really look forward to this chance to chat with everybody. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The first school we're going to start with is Selkirk Montessori in Victoria. If you could unmute yourself, please.
Hi. Ambassador Ray, you represent Canada at the United Nations in New York. Please tell us more about your job and the role that Canada plays in the United Nations.
Well, it's a busy job. First of all, there's 193 countries at the UN, and Canada is one of them. So the first thing we do is we embrace the whole world. We embrace the globe. So my work embraces the concerns of the globe. And I guess I'd say that, you know, my job really is to represent Canada and Canadians. Canada is a major funder. We provide a lot of financial support to the UN. And the UN does a lot of work, not only in its political offices, like the one here in New York, where I live now, and in Geneva, which is the two big headquarters of the UN, but we do work in the environment. We do work on COVID. We do work on economic and social development. And we work in all the developing countries of the world. But in a way, you know, Canada is sort of like the UN in one place. When you think about it, you know, your own classrooms, you have people from all backgrounds and coming from all over the place. We're very proud of our Indigenous heritage, and this connects us with a lot of other countries. There are so many countries that have large Indigenous communities that have been impacted by development and, you know, colonial empires and all of the history of the last couple of hundred years. So there's lots of ways in which Canada really is, as I say often, I say, you know, we're in the world, we're connected with the world, and the world is in us. So it's not like we're representing something that's out there. It's in here. It's in us. And that's, I think, the sense that I try to convey to people, is that we got to think about the world as being inside us as much as we think about, you know, what we're doing in the rest of the world.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just a reminder, students, if you want to introduce yourself, please do that when you first go on. Second question, you call Lumsden Elementary in Saskatchewan.
And I'm from Lumsden, Saskatchewan. Here is my question. You have stated that it is important for teens and around the world to be engaged global citizens. Our vision, Young Global Citizens, is a collective of students who are passionate about making a difference in our world. In particular, what opportunities do you see for young people to affect change? En français, quelles opportunités les jeunes peuvent nous faire pour changer le monde?
Merci pour la question, c'est très clair. Et j'apprécie beaucoup d'entendre la langue française venant de Saskatchewan. Félicitations. I think the global citizen idea is a good one because, it's one that makes us feel that we're part of this amazing planet with several billion people all around the world living in very different circumstances, but sharing our common humanity and sharing our dignity and sharing our rights as members of the global community. And I think the way, you know, we start to serve is by learning, first of all, learning more about the world. And that's very important. It's very important to not only learn by reading, but learn by listening and by sharing the experience of other people, learning more about other cultures and other ways of life, and then connecting it up to the issues that we face at home. So we face issues of pollution and climate change at home, and we face them with other countries. So if you want to get involved on the climate change issue, one of the most practical ways to do that is by seeing how can I help engage on environmental and other issues at home. If you're interested in looking at the issues around peace and security, you might think, well, that's far away. I mean, wars are something that happen in other countries, but actually conflict happens everywhere. So what are you doing about resolving the conflicts in your community or the conflicts in your situation? How do you become in your own life and in what you do, how do you become a messenger for peace and somebody who is a practitioner of peace? One of the great issues in globally is inequality. It's also a great issue in Canada. So what are we doing to express our solidarity with other communities that people aren't left behind? And when you look at the sustainable development goals, the thing that's interesting is the issues that, for example, advancing the interests of women, ensuring that women are equal is one of the goals, right? So you say, well, how do we advance that goal at home? And then when you begin to do that, you begin to see the connection between what you're doing at home and what's happening globally. And it's very important to connect those two things.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is Rossburn Elementary from Manitoba here? So Rossburn Elementary's question was, we recently interviewed National Chief Perry Belgrade of the Assembly of First Nations, and tomorrow we're interviewing President Natan Obed of the ITK, the National Voice for the Inuit. With both of them, we speak about the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. What is the UN's role in making sure that countries that endorse the declaration, like Canada, uphold it?
Well, there's two or three ways in which that happens. First of all, the process of negotiating the UN Declaration took many, many, many years. It took a long time because for a long time, it was difficult for individual groups and citizens to come to the United Nations, because the position of the United Nations at the beginning was, well, no, this is a place where countries come. This is not a place where individual groups come. But eventually, with a lot of persistence at the UN in Geneva and at the UN in New York, the indigenous leadership said, no, we have rights and we have a history that needs to be recognized at the UN. And it's an issue that touches most of the 193 countries, when you think about it. Think about all the Americas, where, you know, the 16th, 17th, 18th centuries, and changed the makeup of the Americas. But before, they were huge indigenous societies that lived on their own. I mean, they lived their own lives, their own way. And that's really what we've got to think about. How do we connect with our history, and how do we connect? Instead, I keep saying, how do we connect with who? Now that it's passed, the UN does a couple of things. One is, the Secretary General, who's sort of like the boss guy of the UN, he appoints a lot of special representatives and special ambassadors who have a job to do, to connect him with the issues that really matter. And so one of the things he has is, in the Secretariat, there's a special representative and a special envoy on Indigenous issues. So that person goes around the world and basically writes a report for the Secretary General every year based on what he sees, and that report becomes public. You can go on the UN website and find those reports. And they paint a picture as to what's going on in different parts of the world, what's happening in Indonesia, what's happening in India, what's happening in parts of Africa, what's happening in the Americas, what's happening in Canada. And so when that becomes a public document, everybody gets a chance to see who's living up to these things and who's not living up to these things. How much more progress is there to be made? Then every year, in this case, it starts next week, actually, we have a permanent forum on Indigenous issues, which goes on for 2 full weeks. We have a full-time forum where Indigenous groups come from all over. This year, of course, it's virtual, and we do a lot of our discussions online. But we really do engage with people in getting a grasp of what's happening and how much more we can do. So that's sort of the structure of what we do. And we have past resolutions, and we try to advance the principles of the declaration and make sure that they're going on. But I have to say that, you know, the work is ongoing. And a lot of people would say, well, yeah, you're not doing enough. And they wouldn't be wrong. So there's still a lot to do as we go forward.
Thank you so much. Question 4, Ecole Alvin Buchwald School in Saskatchewan.
Hello, my name is Chanel and I'm from Saskatoon. In Xinjiang province, there have been many reports of human rights violations. 22 countries, mostly in Europe, wrote a letter saying they are seriously concerned about what is happening to the Uyghur people there. Meanwhile, 38 countries wrote a letter of support for the Chinese government action there. How can we in Canada know the truth about what is going on in another country? How does the government of Canada or the UN get information, and what can Canada do to help the Uyghurs?
Thank you very much. First of all, it's nice to hear from Buchwald School. I knew Mr. Buchwald. He was a senator, and he was also the mayor of Saskatoon, and he was a very nice man. So you should be proud to be in a school that's named after Sid Buchwald. He was a good fellow, very good man. Secondly, you know, in your question, which is really a good question, well, there are ways we find out. I mean, you know, if you go online and look at, you know, good sources of information, Human Rights Watch, the International Crisis Group, those are two examples of well-known human rights organizations that have done a lot to document what is actually happening with and to the Uyghurs. It's hard because of where the Uyghurs live in China, which is up in the northwest part of the country, pretty remote from the center, pretty remote from certainly from Beijing, it's difficult for us to get, we don't have access there. We can't physically travel there and get an independent source of information. So it's you're right, it's difficult. But one of the things we're trying to do is get a delegation to go there. But in order for it to go, we've said we've got to be able to go wherever we want to go. And that's one of the problems that we have. But you can't say that we don't know what's going on. We do have a pretty good idea of what's going on. There's been a lot of reports which are reliable. They're based on eyewitnesses, people who are reporting directly what they're seeing and then telling us what is happening. And it presents a pretty ugly picture. And in fact, if you go online, you can see for yourself. If you just Google Uyghur and look and just see all the evidence, you'll find competing stories. You'll find stories from the Chinese government. You'll find other stories. But I think you can pretty well assess, what am I seeing? Who's taking this picture? How do I rely on it, on what it says? We have a very strong view based on what we've seen, that people are actually being repressed, that people are being jailed, that people are not able to exercise their rights to free speech, and that a lot of people are being put in special schools, which are essentially big open-air prison camps, re-education. But it means people are being denied the right to practice their own religion, are being denied the right to express themselves. So there's quite a lot of evidence that makes it clear that's what's happening.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nice to talk to you.
Tom Thompson School in Ontario. They may not be here as well today. I will read their question. Before becoming Canada's representative to the UN, you served as Canada's special envoy on humanitarian and refugee issues. You have spoken about the emotional toll that hearing the personal stories of displaced and vulnerable people around the world has taken on you. As young people in a connected world, we often read and see awful things happening around the world. How do you think we can know what is going on in the world without being traumatized by it?
That's a good question. I mean, I think we can't, there's always a risk that the other thing will happen, and that is that you see so many terrible things. I mean, I'll just give you an example. Somebody just sent me a video. A friend of mine sent it, and she's somebody that I trust. And it shows a video of a woman in Afghanistan being beaten up in a public meeting. And it's clear from what's being shown is that she's being punished for something. We don't know what it is. But we know that she's being punished, and she's being punished in a very physical way. I think we need to see those pictures. I mean, I think we need to understand what's going on in the world. But I also think we can't let the emotion of it and the trauma of that prevent us from saying, well, what can I do about that? What difference can I make? How can I help to make change happen? And I think that's one of the big problems that we have in the world, is it's not the information. We have enough information. It's that we can't figure out what to do about it. And I think that's the ongoing challenge. But my recommendation is never become insensitive to injustice and to hardship. But what you have to really think about is how can I usefully use my talents and my skill to help make a bad situation better. I think that's the important thing.
Thank you. Selkirk Montessori.
The global pandemic has shown just how connected the world really is. What do you see as some of the benefits and challenges to this global connectedness?
Well, I think one of the things that COVID has done, what's your name? Sorry, I didn't hear your name.
Ina.
Hi, Ina. Thanks very much. I think one of the things we want to do is understand that, yes, it's made us more connected, but it's also shown us, I think, how unequal things are and how it's probably not completely true to say we're all in the same boat, because, in fact, the COVID is having a different impact on different groups of people. Even in Canada, we know that's true. And also globally around the world, it's obviously having a much more serious impact on some groups in some countries than it's having on others. And the distribution of the vaccine is very unequal. So it connects us. But the key thing now is to take this connectedness, if you like, the our ability to find out stuff and then figure out, how do I take this to the next step? How do I raise my voice? And how do I find out more information? Because one of the things we need to use the internet to do is not just to play games on it, not just to send messages to each other, but to use it to really generate the information that we need to have that will be the basis for us to take action. And I think that's one of the exciting things that we can do as citizens. You're as close to the internet as this, and you have this, and then you use this for good, not to waste your time. And that's the key, I think, is to put it to good use.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Blessed Sacrament School, Vancouver, BC.
My student, Sebastian Mirano in grade 5, wants to know, Canada should probably be able to get everyone vaccinated by the end of this year. Since this is a global pandemic and Canada is a leader, does Canada have a plan to share vaccines to other countries and Canada share the vaccine with other people?
Yes, the answer to both questions is yes. The Prime Minister, Mr. Trudeau, has made it very clear that we ordered more vaccines than we would probably need, but we had to do that in order to make sure that we got the supplies we needed, because we don't actually manufacture, we don't make the vaccines in Canada. So the government decided, rightly, in my opinion, that we needed to order more. But the second thing the Prime Minister has said is we are going to share the vaccines with other countries. When we have more than we need, we will share them with other countries. And we've actually created a way to do that. If you Google COVAX, COVAX, you will see that we've set up a place in Geneva, in Switzerland, where orders are paid for by some countries like Canada, and they're used by other countries to buy the drugs that they need, the vaccines they need. And that's a clearing operation. It's a sort of a bank. And we're donors to the bank, and we're donating to the bank so that other countries can draw the COVAX supply of vaccines out. So between having a surplus and also contributing money directly to COVAX, we're helping to make a difference. And we are absolutely sharing. That's what we should do.
Thank you so much, Ambassador. Blessed Sacrament is a special day. It's not like, that's not how we dress every day, but I'm my costume is a Literacy Day, where I'm the aviator from the Little Prince. So thank you so much, Ambassador.
Oh, voilà, j'ai bien le livre. I'm just reading a book about Antoine Saint-Exupéry. Oh, I'm reading his biography. There you go. Yeah, I thought you. I was going to say you look like Biggles. You know, my old children's books.
I'll have to read that too. Thank you, Ambassador.
Thank you.
Thank you, Robert Adams Middle School, Holliston, Massachusetts, the USA.
Bonjour. Hello, Ambassador
Hi.
Ray.
How are you?
I'm well, bonjour. My name is Cynthia Texera, and I'm a French immersion teacher at Robert Adams Middle School in Holliston, Massachusetts. We're just west of Boston. My seventh grade student, Luke, has a question for you on behalf of his French immersion classmates, premièrement en français, and then in English.
Good.
Vous allez entendre encore du français. Bravo.
Voilà, c'est bon.
Bonjour, hello, Mr. Ambassador. So my question in French first is, selon vous, sur quel objectif de développement durable les enfants pourraient-ils avoir le plus d'impact? Et que pourrions-nous faire pour atteindre cet objectif? Puis, in English, what sustainable development goal do you believe students could have the most impact on? And what could we do to achieve that goal?
Eh bien, d'abord, je dirais que c'est difficile à choisir, c'est pas facile. Mais moi-même, je pense que il y a deux grands défis dans le monde. L'inégalité entre les personnes et les pays. Et le deuxième, c'est la question du changement du climat. So, I see two big challenges, not just one. One is definitely climate change, long term. And the second is inequality, which is a big issue. And both of these are addressed in the Sustainable Development Goals. And I think, you know, you need to think about what can I do about climate change? Well, there's a lot you can do. You can become aware of the science and you can talk to people around you about the science and about how it clearly shows that global warming is happening, climate change is happening, and scientists agree that it's caused by the increase in emissions that has happened over about 300 years of industrial life in the world. And we don't have much time to begin to turn this clock back and to really address that question. So it's about the cars we drive. It's about how our families live. How big is our footprint? You know, what are we doing to make it better? What are we doing to make it worse? And understand that, you know, in your lifetime, we have a chance to stop it from getting really bad. But if we just sit back and relax and don't do much, it's going to get much worse. So that's a serious issue. Inequality is really a problem now. It's an inequality in our own countries and in our own neighborhoods. Some people are doing well. Some people are not doing so well. Again, there's things you can do about that as an individual citizen. And be aware, too, about the impact that's having all around. It's about our values and about how we want to live better lives and show some real understanding of what other people are going through and what we can do to try to reach out and help them. Merci pour la question.
Merci. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup.
Merci, madame.
École Lumsden Elementary, Saskatchewan.
Hello, my name is Jackson, and I'm from Lumsden, Saskatchewan. Here's my question. Ambassador Ray, the United Nations hopes to achieve the 7th Sustainable Development Goals by the year 2030. How has the COVID pandemic affected the success of reaching these goals in the given timeline?
Well, short answer, Jackson, is COVID has knocked everybody off course. And that's one of the real challenges that we face now is COVID is just like at home and just like where you are in Lumsden and all around Canada and all around North America. It's affected people's jobs, people's livelihoods, their work, their income, the money they have coming in. It's affected our ability to stay on course with improving education and improving access to healthcare and advancing the inequality between men, the equality between men and women and boys and girls. And these are all examples of the things that, you know, the sustainable development goals, people say to me, what are they? And I say, they're just common sense. What kind of world do we want to live in? We want to live in a world that's healthier and that's cleaner and it's more prosperous and it takes care of people. And that's all, you know, part of what we're trying to build. That's the world we're trying to build. So COVID has absolutely made it much more difficult. And all I can say is we're all really working hard to overcome that. We all know that COVID is it's just bad. I mean, it's just set us back, and we've got to pick ourselves up and figure out how to get to a better place. But it's a big deal.
Thank you.
Thanks for the question.
Ambassador Ray, do you have any final words for the audience today?
Well, no, I really appreciate the chance to speak with you. And before we met half an hour ago, I knew a little bit about you, obviously, because we'd agreed to come on and do this. But it's really good to see you're doing it, and the kinds of questions you're going after and the sorts of things you're looking at across the country. Si je peux dire en français, après, c'est bonne idée de continuer de faire vos travaux, vos efforts. It's good to keep on trying, do the work that you have to do. And we have a lot of progress to make. But it's wonderful to get a chance to meet you. And think about others.
Thank you.
About others. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Merci, Monsieur l'Ambassadeur Ray. Un dernier mot de ma part. Merci beaucoup d'être avec nous. We all know how valuable your time is. And thank you for sharing your valuable time and insightful comments and answers with students across Canada and also the U.S. at this point. We had some from the U.S. also. So thank you very much, and keep up the great work at the UN.
Merci beaucoup. C'est très gentil de votre part. I appreciate it very much. Thank you. Nice to be with you guys.
Everyone can unmute and say goodbye.
Merci.
Bye.
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 Merci. Bye.
Merci. Bye.
Thank you.
Take care, everybody. Take care.
Bye. Bye.
See you.
Bye. Au revoir.
Bye. Bye.